Morning. We are continuing our studies in the book of Romans. We're in chapter 13, and in fact, we're finishing chapter 13. So our passage this morning is Romans 13, 11 through 14. And Paul writes, "Do this, knowing the time that it is already the hour for you to awaken from sleep. For now salvation is nearer to us than when we believed. The night is almost gone. The day is near. Therefore, let us lay aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. Let us behave properly as in the day, not in carousing and drunkenness, not in sexual promiscuity and sensuality, not in strife and jealousy, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lusts." May the Lord bless this reading of His Word and bless our time of studying it together. Let's bow in a word of prayer. Jesus once warned His disciples, "Night is coming." Paul told Christians, "Night is almost gone." Both meant the same thing. Time is short. Don't waste opportunities. I think we're all guilty of doing that. We may be diligent at work, keep our schedules, make all of our appointments on time. We're always looking at our watch. But ignorant of God's clock. That's Paul's warning in our passage in Romans 13. It is already the hour for you to awaken from sleep. The night is almost gone, and the day is near. This present age is ending. The Lord's return is at hand. It's a warning Paul gives as incentive to get active. Earlier, it was events already past that were the basis of Paul's exhortations. Because of the mercies of God, because of Christ's sacrifice, we are to present our bodies to the Lord God as living sacrifices. Gratitude for God's grace should motivate us to do that. But now Paul gives us a new perspective to consider, a reminder of the future so that we will live responsibly in the present. He begins verse 11 with a reference to our Christian duties. He says, "Do this," meaning do all that we have been instructed to do, all that we've been exhorted to do from the previous two chapters, chapters 12 and now chapter 13. In those chapters, Paul instructed us to obey God, be servants to other Christians, be good citizens in society, and good neighbors to all we meet. We are to live selfless lives. But Christians fail to do that. We get distracted by things. We become drowsy in the Christian life. So Paul says, do this. Get active in the things that we have heard and learned, the things that he has exhorted us to do. Get active knowing the time. Knowing that time is short. It is already the hour for you to awaken from sleep, he says. And the already of that statement gives his statement a sense of urgency. There's no time to waste. You are already late, he is saying. Charles Spurgeon preached a sermon on Romans 13, verse 11, entitled, "Wake Up, Wake Up." And he made that point. He made the point that while Christians sleep, things are happening. While Christians sleep, the enemy is active. That's what the Lord taught. In one of his parables, in Matthew chapter 13 and verse 25, he told of a farmer who was sleeping, and while he was sleeping, his enemy came at night and sowed tares among the wheat. That's what the devil does. Now, he's limited in what he can do. We should never think he's not. He's not all-knowing. He is not all-powerful. He is not everywhere. He is not omnipresent, but he is always active. You can call the devil bad, but you cannot call him lazy. And while we are sleeping and losing opportunities to further God's work, the enemy is at work to keep us sleeping and frustrate our mission. Well, that's the reason to wake up. That's reason to get active. But Paul's reason for urgency is given in the statement, "Now salvation is nearer to us than when we believed." In fact, every passing minute brings the Lord's return closer to us. Paul calls it salvation, meaning the consummation of salvation. There are three aspects of salvation, or we could put it this way, as it is sometimes put, three tenses to salvation: past, present, and future. I am saved, I'm being saved, and I will be saved or shall be saved. Salvation is spoken of in that sense as accomplished in the past with our justification, as occurring in the present with our sanctification, and as completed ultimately in the future in our glorification. We have been saved from the guilt of sin, justification. We're being saved from the power of sin presently, through the work of sanctification, and we shall be saved from the very presence of sin altogether in the future with glorification. Well, it's this third aspect of salvation that Paul is referring to here. The future is near, he's saying. The hope of the redemption of our bodies, what Paul wrote of in chapter 8, is about to be realized. It's nearer today than it was when we were converted. We are living at the dawn, so to speak, of all of this. It's still dark. It's still night. That's how Paul describes this age in verse 12. But the light is about to appear. So we are to be busy redeeming the time. Every minute wasted is a minute lost. And when Christ comes, the opportunity for service and the opportunity for eternal blessing in that regard will be past. When Napoleon became emperor and was conquering Europe, he established the Legion of Honor, which was the highest award and medal that France could give. His soldiers would risk their lives in order to get it. And occasionally, he would even take off the medal from his chest and he would place it on one of his brave soldiers. And that, of course, was the most coveted of all. Men will sacrifice their lives for honors and temporary awards. How much better to get Christ's reward, to hear him say, "Well done, good and faithful servant," to gain what is eternal. And that's what we are offered. That's what we will receive. But time is short. Night is almost gone and the day is near. Well, that adds urgency to Paul's plea. But also, it also means that glory is near. The day is the time of light. And light speaks of a lot of things. It speaks of truth, and it speaks of splendor. It speaks of glory, which is what Christ will bring. In the age to come, the world will be filled with God's truth and his glory. That's why Paul speaks of it as the day. The world of this present age has its glory as well. And it is impressive. And I can describe that in a variety of ways. The glory of the world, its power, its edifices, its wealth, all of that is a kind of glory which we recognize. But even the glory that that is of the Lord, that we see and in which we recognize His wisdom and His power, all of that glory combined is like darkness, Paul is saying, compared to the glory to come. And so he calls this present age the night and the future age the day. It will so far eclipse all that Christ will introduce when He comes. Its splendor is that great, so great that everything that preceded it is like darkness compared to the day that He will bring. And we are part of that day which is to come. We have a share in that. We have a share in the future, in the kingdom to come, and the glory. And we have all of the opportunity today to work for that. Now, our labors won't make that happen. I don't think we should understand that we need to get to work and be laboring in order that we bring in the kingdom, or that we move the Lord from His throne to come back. His coming is according to His own timetable, and it will come at the right time, the time that God has appointed. But when we work for Him and we work in His service, we are working according to God's plan. And our labors contribute to that. In the providence of God, they further that along and contribute to our place in the glory to come and our joy in it. Our labors in this present day have great reward and eternal reward. And that's something worth waking up for. But it's also worth waking up for because that is the only way we can progress in the faith and have real fulfillment and joy in this life presently. Fulfillment in our life in Jesus Christ. But again, time is short. Opportunities are always slipping by. The time of the Lord's return is getting closer. The day is near, Paul says. Wake up. Now, his statement, the day is near, should not be interpreted as meaning that Paul's teaching here is that Christ would return in his lifetime, that Paul was expecting that to happen and that he was teaching that, and the early church thought he's coming in this generation. You often hear that. You hear that Paul believed that Christ would return in a relatively short time, but Paul was obviously wrong. His expectation was false, and the suggestion of that is that the whole expectation of the Lord's return is false. But all that's false. Paul was not making any predictions about the Lord's return. No one knows the day or the hour of Christ's return. That's what the Lord Himself taught. They taught that in the Olivet Discourse. Do you think Paul didn't know that? That Paul was unaware of that very fundamental teaching about the return of the Lord? Of course he knew that. But he knew that He would come. And that His coming is imminent, meaning it could happen at any time. Theoretically, potentially, it could have come in Paul's day. It could have come in Luther's day. It could have come in any. It can come in our day. We have that potential. It is imminent. It could happen at any moment. Nothing stands in its way. And Paul is saying to his generation, be ready. And he's saying to us as well, speaking to the church down through the ages, be ready. It is the blessed hope. And it's the next event in God's plan. Henry Alford, who was the Dean of Canterbury and wrote a series of commentaries, a set of commentaries back in the mid to late 19th century, commentaries that are still used very much today, made this comment. He put it this way: on the certainty of the event, our faith is grounded. By the uncertainty of the time, our hope is stimulated and our watchfulness aroused. And our watchfulness will not be in vain, because our hope is not empty. It is certain. God's word declares it to be. We do have hope. We have real hope. Not the kind of hope that most of you have, that the Cowboys will win this afternoon and that hope can equally be disappointed. We have hope that's certain. It's going to happen. And that distinguishes us from the world around us with all of its confidence and thoughts of certainty. But Paul said as much in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4 and verse 13, where he spoke of unbelievers as the rest who have no hope. And their hopelessness has been expressed in various ways, from the old myths that men believe to the modern scientific theories that are accepted as true. The Norsemen, for example, the Vikings who lived in the cold of northern Europe, believed that ultimately the frost giants would conquer all and the future was one of ice and darkness. Well, that's a myth, obviously, but it's not unlike the predictions of modern science on the fate of the ever-expanding universe. And no more hopeful either, as the galaxies fly apart from each other and the distances between them increase. Space will get emptier and the sky darker. Eventually, the stars will burn out and there will be eternal night. Well, if that's really the future, why act? Why do anything? Why have plans and aspirations? Why even get out of bed? Because ultimately, everything is coming to nothing. According to that, life is meaningless. That's not the interpretation they give to it, I don't think. But that's certainly the implication. Life is meaningless and hopeless, according to modern man and his worldview. But we know that's not true. We know the future, and we know it's glorious. Paul tells that night is almost gone, and the day is near. No eternal night. The day is coming. That should, as Alford said, arouse watchfulness. I think this is an example of doctrine being practical. So important that we know the Bible and that we know the ideas of the Bible, the doctrines of the Bible. It is practical. And here, the practical effect of eschatology, the study of last things or future events, is that it gives us hope. Hope as reliable as God Himself. And it gives us incentive for action. We see that in the second half of verse 12. It begins therefore, which introduces the proper response to knowing the time in which we live, knowing that salvation is near. We are to lay aside the deeds of darkness and put on the armor of light. So not only are we to wake up and get up, but we're to get dressed as well. First, we are to take off our night clothes, as it were, the deeds of darkness. Darkness is the natural environment of those who are up to no good, people who are out to carry out nefarious deeds. They do it under cover of darkness. So deeds of darkness are wicked deeds, bad behavior, sinful habits. They are things that are done in secret. We are to put them off, Paul says. We're to stop doing them. We have been saved from all of that, rescued from the domain of darkness and transferred to the kingdom of God's Son, Paul wrote in Colossians chapter 1 and verse 13. So we're to live according to that. We are to dress differently. Paul says we are to put on the armor of God. That is the appropriate clothing for us to wear, because as James Denny wrote, the Christian life is not a sleep but a battle. Paul certainly agreed. In fact, Professor Denny is agreeing with Paul. He taught that all through his epistles. He often speaks in terms of spiritual armor. He puts things in a martial or military frame. In 2 Corinthians chapter 6 and verse 7, he speaks of the weapons of righteousness for the right hand and the left hand. And of course, in Ephesians 6, he describes the full armor of God and tells us to take it up. He does the same in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5 and verse 8. He describes the pieces of armor as the helmet of hope, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, the sword of the truth. This is prominent in the apostles' writings because it's true. The Christian life is not asleep. It's a battle. It's a warfare. Now, all of these armaments that he describes are metaphors. They speak of Christian graces. They are virtues we are to live by. They indicate how we are to behave. Our dress is our behavior. These are virtues described as pieces of armor, but they are the virtues upon which we are to act according to how we are to live. We're to live by faith. We are to pursue righteousness. We are to be sure of our future hope. We're to be motivated by that great doctrine. We are to know Scripture. We are to be able to use Scripture on ourselves and on others. We're to be actively involved in a godly life of service. But Paul puts his instruction in a military way because he knew that whatever else life may be, it is first of all a spiritual war. And so we need to be armed for conflict because the enemy is all around us with the world and the flesh and the devil. And the enemy doesn't sleep. The battle never really lets up. Paul gives the same counsel in verse 13, but in a different description. He says, let us behave properly as in the day. Behave, this word behave is literally walk or walk about. So Paul's description moves from getting dressed to walking around, from clothing to behavior, which is what walking illustrates. Very common description in the Bible of the life of a child of God. We walk. It describes the course of a person's life, putting into practice the virtues of this armor of light that we put on. And Paul tells us that we are to live in a way that would be seen as someone living in the daytime. I mean, one, people who live in the daytime live properly because they're being watched. That's where behavior is proper in the day as opposed to at night when the cover of darkness can hide the deeds that people want to do secretly. So we're to live as in the day. We are to live in obedience. We are to have conduct that is appropriate to who we are. It is to correspond to living in the light, not behavior that occurs in the night. Not in carousing and drunkenness, Paul says. Not in sexual promiscuity and sensuality. Not in strife and jealousy. All six vices are the product of self-will and self-interest in the areas of drink, sex, and social relationships. Each is a failure in the area to love one's neighbor. That's what Paul has spoken about, really, in the previous passages, about love. And these vices are a contradiction of that very thing, of loving one's neighbor. And we shouldn't forget that what Paul is writing here was written to Christians. Paul began the epistle in chapter 1 by addressing all who are beloved of God in Rome, called as saints. So he's writing to saints. He's writing to those who have been set apart by the gospel and the grace and the mercy of God. These are saints that Paul is instructing, not to be drunk and promiscuous. Now, commenting on that, Leon Morris wrote in his commentary, "We should not think that first century Christians came from the most upright and honorable sections of society. Rather," he said, "the gospel took up and transformed many who were the dregs of society." Paul is mindful of this and warns against relapse. That's a possibility. It's a very clear and present danger with all of us. Relapse, falling back into the old life. It's the same for us as it was for them. Human nature is the same. The situation is always the same. And the fact is, Christians bring old baggage into the new life. We are regenerated in a moment, and we become new creatures, new people. But there's still a lot of the old life that's there. We're not the old man and the new man. The old man is dead. But that new man has a lot of old baggage from the old life. God doesn't say, "Clean up your life first, then I'll save you." He saves us where we are. He saves us in that old life. He transforms us into something new at that moment. But we need to be continually saved, as it were. We need that continuous work. That's sanctification. It's that second tense of salvation. God's present work of saving us from the power of sin. We've been saved from the penalty of sin. We've been justified. That can never change. But we need constant salvation from the very power of sin. And one means that God uses to do that, uses in our sanctification, in transforming our lives, is admonitions such as this, warnings and encouragements that Christians respond to. And so to prevent relapses into the sinful behavior of the past, or to draw people out of it if they were in that very kind of thing, Paul gives this instruction to dress decently and walk appropriately. He's not finished. In verse 14, he returns to the image of dress. "Put on the Lord Jesus Christ, and make no provision for the flesh in regard to its lusts." That is a command that, again, is urgent. If I can use a little Greek grammar, it's put in the aorist tense, which is a very common tense in Greek. It's very simple. It's the past tense, the simple form of the past tense. But it also has the sense of a definite positive act, and it has that with this verb, this command. And the sense of it is, we are to do this now without delay. Put on the Lord Jesus Christ now. Don't delay. How do we do that? How does the Christian put on Christ? We're already in Christ. We've been placed in Christ. How do we put him on now? Well, we put him on by exhibiting his character, by exhibiting his virtues. And we do that by doing what Paul instructed us to do back in chapter 6 and verse 11. Consider yourselves dead to sin, but alive to God in Christ Jesus. Consider the old man that you once were to be dead, to be crucified with Christ, and your new person to be alive in him. Believe that. Appropriate his life, because being in Christ, we do have the life of Christ in us. And we have his life through the Holy Spirit. We have power. We're not told to kind of gin up the life and the power within us. It is there. So he's saying, appropriate that. We can do that as we walk by faith in the power of the new life. And then take very practical steps. He says, make no provision for the flesh. How would we not make provision for the flesh? As our minds are governed by the principles of God's Word, we begin to think the thoughts of Christ. We have His desires, and we begin to follow Him, who, as Peter said in Acts chapter 10, went about doing good. That's what we're to do. So we do that positively by emulating Him, by doing the things that we're told to do, we're instructed to do. But also, we don't go to places where we shouldn't go, where we would dishonor Christ, which means we avoid places, we avoid circumstances that are inappropriate for a Christian and would present temptations to the flesh. As I said, I don't know if it was in the lesson or in my prayer, but I said the Christian life's not all that complicated. It's not as though God has given us all kinds of spiritual and mental gymnastics to follow in order to accomplish what He would have for us. It involves a lot of common sense. Don't go to places you shouldn't be. You know what tempts you. You know where your weaknesses lie. Don't give anything that would feed the flesh in that way. That's what Paul is saying. Instead, what we're to do is manifest the virtues of Christ: humility, obedience, compassion, kindness, gentleness, patience, mercy, and truth. We're to show love to one another in this auditorium, in this church. That's to be a goal that we set for ourselves and what we seek to do. We speak truth in love. That's how we carry on the warfare we are in. And we're to be diligent in it. We are not to sleep. And if we are asleep, then we're to wake up. We're to get dressed and get going in the Christian life. Time is short. The day is near. That is Paul's exhortation. He is not addressing non-believers. He's addressing Christians, those who are justified. And so he doesn't threaten us with hellfire. That's for the unbeliever. Christians can fall into sin and slothfulness. They can fall asleep, but they can never fall away from Christ and lose their salvation. Paul's warning is one of missed opportunity. What a terrible disappointment it will be to meet Christ, and we will all meet Christ, but to meet Him and have very little to show for our lives to the one who's done everything for us. And so Paul urges us to get active. Yet while this text is for Christians, it has been marvelously used in the conversion of unbelievers. The book of Romans has such texts. Romans chapter 1, verse 17, "The just shall live by faith," was instrumental in the conversion of Luther. And this text, Romans 13, verses 13 and 14, was used in Augustine's conversion. He wrote about it in his Confessions, his spiritual autobiography. And if you've read it, or if you've heard me talk about Augustine's Confessions, you know that he wrote it in the form of a prayer. It's as though it's all written to the Lord God. He's talking to Him in a prayer. And one of the opening statements of that, perhaps the most famous line from his Confessions, is, "You have made us for yourself, and our heart is restless until it rests in you." And that was his experience, restless until he came to the cross. But until then, all of his life was spent seeking that rest. As a youth, he looked forward in sensual pleasure. He lived an immoral life. His mother, Monica, was a Christian. He heard the gospel from her and from others, but he prayed, "Give me chastity, but not yet." He was afraid that God would hear him quickly and heal him quickly of his lust. That's what he said. He said, I wish to have satisfied his lust rather than extinguished. Now, how typical that is. "Lord, save me, but not quite yet. I have some living to do." He believed sex was how he would find happiness, which is not an uncommon thought among a young person. But he didn't find it there. And so he sought it in intellectual pursuits. He was a brilliant man, a brilliant student, and he pursued philosophy aggressively, but wasn't satisfied again. And then he pursued happiness and fulfillment in a career in rhetoric, which was in that day, the fourth and the fifth centuries, a very important profession. It was important because it taught people how to argue a case, if they were a lawyer or if they were a man of the state, a politician, how to speak well, how to give a learned discourse and sway people's opinions. It was a very important position to have, and so he pursued that. He pursued a career in rhetoric and pursued it wholly. He was on the road to a brilliant career as a professor of that subject. It took him from North Africa to Rome, and then from Rome it took him north to the city of Milan. And it was there that in Milan that he came under the influence of the bishop of that city named Ambrose. And Ambrose was at that time the great preacher of the Latin church, the Western church. He preached the Bible and he taught Christian doctrine. And Augustine went to hear Ambrose, went to hear him mainly out of a desire to hear this great speaker, this great preacher, this rhetorician. So he went to hear him, but as he sat under the preaching of Ambrose, Augustine came under the conviction of sin and began to have a great struggle within his soul. And it reached a crisis one day while he was in a garden. He was in great distress. You know the story, I'm sure. He heard a child next on the other side of a wall singing. And the words that the child was singing were, "Take up and read, take up and read." He said he'd never heard the song before and that he never heard it afterwards, but he took that as a command from God. And so immediately his disposition changed. He calmed himself, he took the Bible, and he opened it at random to this text. He read, "Not in rioting and drunkenness, not in chambering and impurities, not in strife and envying, but put on the Lord Jesus Christ and make no provision for the flesh in its lusts." Augustine wrote at the end of this sentence, "As if before a peaceful light streaming into my heart, all the dark shadows of doubt fled away." Now that's the power of the Word of God. That's the power of Scripture. It's not like any other book. This is unique. Augustine's Bible study method was not good, but God's power is not limited. He used all of that. He used his word in a great way in that man's heart to make him know his sin and understand that salvation is in Christ alone. In that garden, he put on Christ and became Saint Augustine, one of the most influential Christians in the history of the church. God has used this text to arouse Christians from their drowsiness and to awaken unbelievers from their spiritual death. He does it. He does that through his word. So the question is, how does it speak to you this morning? If you're a Christian, are you sleeping? Then wake up. For now salvation is nearer to us than when we first believed. Christ is coming. That's a truth. We shouldn't dismiss it. We shouldn't put it aside. We should focus on it routinely. We should always have that before us. Christ is coming. Our salvation is nearer today. It's nearer now than it was when we began this sermon. Night is coming, Jesus said, when no man can work. So time is short for us to develop our minds through the knowledge of Christian doctrine. Time is short for us to practice it before the world in a life of faith, for us to help others in acts of service. Time is short for that. This is a word for all of us, though. Night is coming. Night is almost gone. And if you are not a Christian, then as Mr. Spurgeon wrote, it's time for you to wake up. For now is your damnation nearer than when you first heard the gospel and rejected it. Now, that's sobering, but that's true. Christ is coming. He may come soon. May he come for you with his reward and not his wrath. Look to Christ if you haven't. Trust in him. He died for sinners. He bore their sins. He did it all so that all who believe in him at that very moment will be saved forever, justified, sanctified, glorified. May God help you to do that. Let's pray. Father, we do thank you for your goodness and your grace and for all of the instruction and exhortations and warnings that the apostle gives us in these four verses. They remind us of great truth, that your son is coming again, and he is coming soon. He may come in our lifetime. We have that hope. It's a genuine hope that we have. But the certainty of it is he will come. And we will all face him someday. May we face him well. May we have a life that we can offer to him that is something that he says and receives with the words, "Well done, good and faithful servant." So Lord, bless us in that way. And if there be anyone who has not trusted in him who is with us this morning, bless them with faith in the Savior. We pray these things in his name. Amen.